Hello, welcome to what will be a brief yet comprehensive discussion surrounding IT due diligence and its relevance in a recent middle market private equity transaction. Just a quick note to answer a question that's already been posed. We will touch on cyber diligence. It's absolutely relevant to IT diligence. They are both important. They are both different. We will likely have a deeper dive into cyber diligence and a follow-up date likely in this format, but at a later time. I'm Cameron Smith, Business Development Director for Cherry Bekaert's Private Equity Services Practice, joined here today with my colleague, Dan Hewlin, who is a leader in Cherry Bekaert's Digital Services Practice. He's also a fractional CIO for Cherry Bekaert's clients. And we have our special guest, Mr. Alex Mishkin with Lime Rock New Energy. It is a growth equity fund that is investing in companies in the energy space. And we're very happy to be here today. Thank you for joining us. We're gonna jump right into the discussion. And if you have any questions, there is a questions arrow drop down into the menu box to the right of your screen. If you would please ask your questions in that box, we will save time at the end to answer them. Alex, if you would please kick us off and give just a little bit more background into Lime Rock New Energy, the types of companies you're investing, and also mentioning this recent acquisition that we're gonna be discussing today, coincidentally, that's being announced publicly today.
Great. Well, thank you, Cameron. Thank you, Dan, for the opportunity to be here. It's a pleasure. I know there are quite a few investors on the phone, so I won't go into too much detail, but Lime Rock New Energy is a private equity fund that was launched in 2019. It's the third fund strategy within Lime Rock Management, a private equity firm that's now 22 years old. That has spent its entire history focused on growth equity investments in the energy sector. The fund family that I'm a managing director and co-founder of is focused on the energy transition, again, from a growth equity perspective. So we're looking for companies that are graduating from the venture space that have proven technologies and proven business models and are being stood up to start to solve some of the inefficiencies that are beginning to emerge due to the transition to a lower carbon world. We're looking typically to make $30 to $90 million investments per company. We are targeting a $600 million fund. So that's a little bit about us. To switch to how we began to work with Cherry Bekaert, I think as many of you know, when you look at a operating company in particular, or really any investment as an investor, one of the things that you do at the outset, if you think the investment is attractive, is you begin to identify the risks, those that are actual, what I'll call substantive risks, and those that are areas where you want to conduct confirmatory diligence just to make sure that there's nothing out there that you've missed. And as we look across the range of companies that we're screening and spending time on, there are these days very few of them that are not depending on some form of IT. And it really spans the gamut from those that may themselves be IT companies that are building a product that is in fact a software product that they're attempting to sell to customers. So that's one bucket. A second bucket might be companies that have built their own bespoke, if you will, IT product that they're using internally for their own purposes to try to solve other problems for customers through a product or service. And then there are those that may be sort of what I'll call low-level users that may be depending on email and data storage systems and other things like that that may be on the simpler end. With any of those, you know, as we would if we came across a company that has manufacturing and might have environmental issues, we would go out at a certain point in our diligence and hire environmental experts. We're certainly going to go out and find accounting experts to do quality of earnings analyses We're going to hire lawyers. We're not going to attempt to draft the documents ourselves. So too with IT, when we see a company that is depending in a mission critical way on an IT platform, we may be energy experts, but we don't pretend to be IT experts. And this most recent acquisition that we're announcing now is a great example of that. It falls into the middle category that I just described. They had built within a large corporate entity a proprietary software program that they were using internally to promote their business, which is largely a service business. As we approached it, we saw the value in the platform. We understood what it did. We understood that they had done something very creative internally. But in my first call to Dan, I said, look, we don't really know what's inside the black box here. We don't know if this is a really elegant piece of software design that's very stable and able to scale, or whether it's, I think to use a colloquial term, a Rube Goldberg contraption. And we really need some help in figuring that out. We also need some help because this is going to be a carve out, and we need to understand how that's going to work most efficiently for us, both in terms of the code, but also in terms of the people that have built the code. Because even if we have the code, whether legally or from an operational point of view, I think as we all know on the phone, every form of IT is dynamic and constantly being updated. Whether it's on your cell phone or on your computer, and certainly more complex systems than that. And so that's why we reached out to Cherry Bekaert to help us with that piece of diligence. I think we're here today, obviously, because we had a great experience. We really got the information that we needed. They were able to dig fairly deep with the IT team and surface for us both the operational issues that we should focus on, as well as the financial issues that we needed to focus on. So I'll stop there, and obviously happy to go into more detail on any of that.
Yeah, Alex, just a quick question on the carve out piece. Can you go a little deeper into that nuance? And since you've got some investors on the phone, how that impacted the decision-making with the IT diligence project?
Sure. So in this particular case, one of the complexities was that this was going to be a carve-out, which meant that the seller wanted to continue to use certain portions of the software platform going forward on a proprietary basis. Other portions they wanted to share with us for a period of time. And then other portions would become ours as part of the acquisition. And so, understanding how all three of those pieces would actually be physically, if you will, or electronically separated was a question that we needed help with. We also, the platform continues to be one that is being developed. So we needed to answer the question of who's going to continue to develop this. Who is going to build the modules that are on the drawing board as we go forward? And how are we going to transition? And it turned out to be a two-year period that we negotiated. How are we going to transition from being dependent upon the seller's IT team almost entirely at the outset to our own standalone team within the company over a period of time? And how much is that going to cost? What are the underlying software platforms that we have to license? What are the risks with respect to open source code that might make our proprietary platform in the public domain? And what about the platforms that this company has chosen to use? Are they ones that are going to continue to be able to scale as our company grows, which is the primary reason that we're investing in it? And so Dan and his team were able to help us understand all the licensing fees that we might incur. They were very helpful in designing for us a plan of transition with all the costs involved and presenting various options. As we were actually trying to put a value on the platform, they were very helpful to us in valuing the underlying software that we were acquiring. So all of those were elements that were very important that we leaned on Dan and his team to do for us. And then we began to look at some risks about, you know, what happens if this bad thing happens or that bad thing, what will it cost for us to ameliorate it, such as what happens if the seller, for whatever set of reasons, is no longer in a position to support us during our two-year transition period. How do we deal with that? And so we were able to not only start to develop an operational plan that we now in our first 100 days are beginning to execute on, but we were also able to financially understand what it's going to cost, what the risks are, and come up with some backup plans in case plan A doesn't work out.
Great, thanks. So Dan, switching over, kind of what is the process? You know, what is, when taking an approach to a project like this, you know, where do you start? And yeah. I knew you have a screen to share with us.
Yeah, absolutely. So just want to make sure you all can see the screen okay there. So just at a high level for this particular engagement, I did put together a little graphic that just illustrates how we approach, you know, all diligence activities have common features to them. And in some cases, such as this with a carve out, that gets a lot deeper. So I just wanted to share this, this flow here. First starts out with intros. And what's really important is in that first block is establish trust and rapport. You know, as a outside party and you are an agent and representative, if you will, of the PE firm, you want to make sure that you're developing a really solid rapport with the people on the other side. Ultimately, this is a desire to be a partnership and equitable and mutually beneficial for both sides. So it's not postured like perhaps an audit would be. It's postured as let's understand what you have. Let's assuage any concerns that you might have about how deep or the types of things that are going to be exposed, and know that we're here to help. Sometimes when you say you're here to help, right, that's not the greatest phrase to use. People may run away, but it is important to develop that rapport. And so we do that first off. We also set expectations and gathering materials very commonly in PE and other diligence exercises. You give them an initial set of questions, as well as request various materials that they have. Moving on from there, we dive into the body of the diligence itself, where we look at people and governance. You know, background and skills is so important. Do you have A players in the management team, especially, whether it be a CIO, CTO, and we did that in this case as well. Oftentimes, we will also, in evaluating business processes, we'll be talking to CFOs and COOs as well. But that's very important to make sure that they have the background that's going to enable the organization to scale. From there, we look at controls, you know, your policies, your procedures. Do you have those controls in place? What does the budget look like? What kind of annual burn do you put in for innovation? What's the split on the budget between operations and innovation dollars? The portfolio is really around the projects that you have planned, especially for a software company, which this was. That's very important to understand what's on deck and what's in the icebox. What are the major features that you're trying to roll out for your system? In the software and DevOps side, we dig in with programmer types that are on our side, with programmer and other infrastructure engineering in the software and DevOps model, and asking, you know, big questions there on scalability. That's always a question for PE. Can I scale this thing? What's the architecture and code quality look like? This is, you know, as Alex was saying, we don't want the Rube Goldberg machine here. And you ask basic question, how old is that software stack? Are they utilizing nascent technologies in cloud, for example, to drive innovation forward quickly, and that scale is baked in, these types of questions. And then DevOps, how do they go through that process of continuous development to continuous integration testing, and then that continuous deployment? That's also very important. We see all sorts of practices out there, from the waterfall method, which is very legacy, to agile methods and combinations therein. So evaluate DevOps, see what it looks like. Now, on security practices, this is where I want to say that this is very light. It is not a cyber diligence, and I want to make that distinction here. But we do want to look at, do you have any kind of risk management program in place? Do you have your controls? What are you doing with respect to cyber liability insurance, as an example? And what are you doing in terms of training your people? But I do want to qualify it. It is not a cyber diligence. That is another service that we offer at Cherry Bekaert, and it goes very deep, leveraging things like the NIST body of work. If you're a government agency like 853 and ISO 27001 for data center evaluations and the security practices therein. But it's always important in any kind of diligence, at least to hit some of the top level things and ask the questions to identify red flags and come back to the PE and say, listen, I think we really need to go deeper here because you've got a lot of risk and you don't know what you're going to get into. We do talk about network security practices, and we talk about information security, data leakage. You know, do they have any controls in place for that, or technological components? Moving on to the infrastructure and operations, obviously we're taking a look at data center. You know, how do they have data centers? Where are they? We especially like to see that they're leveraging cloud technologies because it's such a game changer. Just as a story, you know, I had responsibility in the past for global data centers, and it would take about 6 months to take equipment and systems and burn them in and get them shipped and get them out of customs and rack them and stack them and fire them overseas. You know, 6 months to do that. And now today in the cloud, we can do that in about a week. I mean, these are game changers, and companies that are trying to build and scale have to leverage these cloud technologies if they want to compete. Disaster recovery and business continuity, obviously very important to see what kind of replication that they have in place, and that can get very technical very quickly because you have different components from systems and servers to databases to the way in which people are routing around the internet to get your content. So we dig in there. Desktop and client management, basic blocks and tackles. You know, how long does it take for somebody to get a computer? Do they have that really outsourced more and more because it's a commodity service? It's not something that's going to drive your business forward necessarily on that front. So if they're spending a lot of time there, then we advise, you know, let's not do that. The carve out was obviously in this instance, this was very important because virtually half of the organization was going to be carved out. And there is a lot of detail when you're doing that, that you've got to get into. And so that establishment of a project plan that I mentioned there, the licensing and contracts, you know, over what period of time are the various components going to be separated? And in a way that if you're utilizing, especially cloud, and that consumption and the costs, you don't want to just double the cost. It's not like you want to forklift the entire thing over to both sides and double the cost. So you've got to be very careful about that. You also have to dig in the carve out in anticipation of legal and the contract closing. What is the IP, the intellectual property transfer? Who's going to retain what? And over what time frame will IP be released and or contracted back or licensed back? From entity to entity. And of course, then the financing. What does that mean from a dollars and cents standpoint? If we've got to, both from a person and personnel, such as development teams, what are those going to cost? What is the market rate? Helping to negotiate what those rates are going to be. All of those details come into carve outs, and they're particularly difficult when it's not a whole company. We've done carve outs where it's a whole company as a subsidiary or a business unit that is going to come out of a larger company. Those are a lot easier in some respects, but when it's all meshed together, you really got to take some time. And then finally, just on the closing of the transaction, we do consult with legal oftentimes when there's questions, especially things like open source that come up. We help give guidance with schedule preparations and reviews to make sure that everything is matched properly for what was discussed in the diligence. And of course, just negotiation can come in as well, right? We're trying to figure out, well, who's going to own what? Is that really is that an important factor for the profitability of the new company that's going to be created? So that's a little bit about our diligence process, and I'll turn it back to you, Cameron.
Thanks, Dan and Alex. So you mentioned a couple of things. You said, you know, we're energy guys. We're not IT guys, and you mentioned some of the value that you've found in this process. If you could, you know, now that the deal's closed, are you realizing that value? Would you do this again?
Oh yeah, absolutely. You know, and maybe just to give a little bit more tangible sense of the deal so that I think the audience has a sense of what we're talking about. We're going to announce it today, but given all the other news flow, I think we pushed the announcement to next week. But you know, this is a company that we bought out of Schneider Electric. And it's really a buy and build strategy that they've already started to execute that's focused on the question of the strategy to decarbonize the economy is increasingly focused on electrification. The idea that if you can electrify, whether it's heat pumps or cars or anything else, you can then start to push clean energy into that system. One of the bottlenecks is who's going to install all of that electrical equipment. If you think about an EV charger that somebody wants to install in their garage, there's really no nationally branded quality controlled network or company that is set up to do that. And Schneider had been incubating this company for about 4 years and is co-investing with us, but we will be the majority owners. And so the software platform that we are talking about is really what is controlling and monitoring and scoring the network of electricians who are going to be doing this work and serving them up when a particular job order comes in for a particular customer. And so it's crucial and essential and a major competitive advantage for the company, but it's something they're using internally. And if it doesn't work, very rapidly, their large customers, who include companies like General Motors and Schneider itself, are not going to have a lot of patience. So that's why this was so important at a high level. And then, you know, in terms of value, you know, a lot of value is in knowing things ahead of time and being able to budget appropriately for various different scenarios. And to have a best practices plan in place. So, you know, I would say a lot of the value here was really coming up with a smooth transition that is seen as a smooth transition by the sellers as well as by us, and coming up with a plan to help us staff up internally over a couple of year period to really make this a standalone entity, you know, less than halfway through our investment hold period. And so when I think about value, had we tried to do that without Dan and his team, it is inevitable we would have overlooked a lot of things, made incorrect assumptions, and, you know, be in a position of trying to figure out things after the fact. That now I think we're well set up to execute on. So, you know, there's no question that we have saved hundreds of thousands, if not sort of seven figure sums by figuring this out in advance.
When being a middle market private equity fund, you know, assuming, well, obviously you don't have Dan's on staff to do these things. You know, and so perhaps this is replicable to other, you know, sector focused fund investors like yourselves.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, in a somewhat contrarian view, I would think that folks who are focused on investing in sectors other than IT may find even more value out of working with Cherry Bekaert than teams that are really just focused on IT investments. Because I think there, my instinct is, and I spoke to folks I know who are part of IT investment strategies on the VC side in particular, there is a lot of resident knowledge about platforms and scaling and because that's core to the investment strategy. You know, folks there I've talked to tend to reach out more just for the cyber piece of this in particular. And sometimes if it's particularly complex on the machine learning side, for help there, but certainly for an energy investor, I would imagine a consumer products investor, a healthcare investor, all of these businesses are relying more and more on ever more complex IT systems, and ensuring that that is a stable, low risk element of the investment, I think is key.
Thank you. All right, so Dan, kind of wrapping up, I'm a buyer. How do I know, how can I quickly self-assess, is IT diligence something that I really need to consider in an acquisition?
Yeah, appreciate that. I'm gonna share my screen yet again so we can talk about that. So this is just self-assessment 101. When you're considering a new target, new acquisition, and thinking about IT diligence, here's some quick questions. You know, people in governance, I mentioned this in the last slide. Do you have A players in management that are really going to help you to grow and scale? They understand where the technology industry is going, and can help lead the organization to that next level. That any controls whatsoever, right? They don't have controls, and we often see this, right? With mom and pop type shops that come up, 2 million to 3 million of EBITDA or 4 million, oftentimes they've neglected this. They don't have the controls, and this is part of the professionalization. How much of the tech budget is for innovation? So if you have, you know, 95% of the IT budget is going towards just keeping the lights on and doing doing commodity-based IT budgeting, then you can know pretty well right away that they're not using technology strategically to grow their business. And with so many processes innervated by technology, that's obviously a red flag. On the business operations side, now this didn't happen in this particular transaction, but it is important and is another factor in our diligence activities, is looking at that quote to cash, procure to pay, record to report, demand to available, walking down those core processes for the organization, whether it be a manufacturer or a professional services firm or a biotech or what have you, is just really important. You know, how much friction is there in the quote to cash cycle? How hard is it for a customer to find you, to place an order, and for that order to roll through to fulfillment? This is all part of digitalization and that maturity to become a digital type of company, which so many are pushing to become, to drive out cost and waste and errors. So on the business operations side, you want to ask that question, you know, how much friction is there in that? Are you drowning in spreadsheets? You know, we see Excel financials and Excel operations, if you catch my drift, too often than not, even in large companies. And so we want to highlight those things. Where do you have automation applied? You know, that's an easy one. If they don't really have automation, whether it's something as simple as AP automation or AR, or if they're a large organization, they have workflow and forms and those types of things, are they automating? And this is also super important in business intelligence. So many companies are driving the car, if you will, out the back window, looking backwards. And they don't have the dashboard right in front with those dials saying, you know, how did I do today? Moving those key metrics up front in more real time, that's an important question as well. On the security practices, right, here's an easy one. Any security events over the last 2 years? If so, well, tell me about it. Are they training their people to be that human firewall? This is of course, one of the biggest risk factors is that one person, right, who continues to click on the phishing emails. So are they doing anything to mitigate against that? And how do you protect company information? Just give me a perspective. Software and DevOps, again, I mentioned before, you know, how old is the software? If it's 10, 15 years old, maybe it's even 20 years old, you're gonna be leveraging more legacy type tools and technology, thought patterns. The advent of the cloud probably hasn't been considered. So that's an important question. How often do you release new features? You know, in agile type of methods for development, you see people that are developing and deploying new capabilities, sometimes very sophisticated, in just a matter of a few weeks. So what does that cadence look like? And are you leveraging any cloud services at all? Obviously, from what I've said before, it's so important. And then finally, just on the infrastructure and operations, you know, how do you back your data up? How quickly can you recover? When's the last time you tested that? How long does it take to deploy a new computer? That should just be a simple, very simple process of requisition to fulfillment. And who do you ask for help? You know, how do your people get help? So they, and it may be something very low level, right? They're just trying to get their computer to work. Or it may be something much more. They're they're trying to solve a pretty significant business problem. And again, what they know is Excel. And so they start building an application. Now they should be able to ask advisor type resources, whether that's a fractional CIO, CTO type person, or you have someone on staff that really knows how to guide the organization on how to build applications and new capabilities. So that's self-assessment 101, some basic things that would be helpful, I think, to folks as they're considering going further in IT diligence.
Well, thank you both. I'd like to open up to anyone that has any questions. I don't see that we've received any in our little questions box. Dan, if you don't mind going to the last slide with our contact information is listed here. Unfortunately, Alex's partner, Oliver, ran into a conflict, but he would also be available if you'd like to speak to him from either one of them at Lime Rock New Energy. And Dan and I are listed above. If there are no questions, then wish you all to have a fantastic Thursday. And please reach out if you'd like to speak offline.
Thanks so much.
Thanks, everyone.
Thanks, Cameron. Thanks, Alex.
Have a great day.
Bye-bye.